Good Sunday morning, everyone. We will begin today by singing together, Voice Still and Small.
My name is Rick Cousins. I am a member of the Sunday Services Committee, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Danbury. We're very glad that each of you are able to join us this morning together in community so that we can ensure that social distancing does not mean social disengagement. Our weekly services are more than just gathering of our physical bodies. It's the forming of our sacred time that we make together. Whether you are well versed in technology of teleconferencing or whether this is your first venture, we welcome you. For those of you new among us or reconnecting with fonder hearts, we invite you to introduce yourselves and where you are connecting from in the chat box as you are comfortable. Whatever the faith and traditions of your past, whatever your theological stance, whatever your heritage, whoever you are and whomever you love, we welcome you. You can learn more about us on our website or our Facebook page. We encourage you to share our Facebook page and reach out to others who may be isolated at this time and might benefit from the spiritual connection of our loving community. Please note, I'd like to make the following announcements, please. Today, we are going to be meeting at the Chapter House on 24 Clapboard Ridge Road And the event is called Bring Your Own Lunch Meetup. And it's to celebrate both being together as well as the departure of our beloved Reverend Heather. So please bring your lunch, chairs, blankets, etc., so that you'll be comfortable. It's a great opportunity to be able to catch up with Reverend Heather, who has dedicated 3 years of her time with us here at UUCD. Today, we welcome the Reverend Holly Brown, who is ordained and serves as the ministerial intern at Piedmont Unitarian in Charlotte and Salisbury, North Carolina. We'd like to say thank you very much for attending, Reverend Holly, and we appreciate your time and hope to have you back sometime soon. After the service, we invite you to stay. We'd like you to stay and participate in our breakout groups for individual connections and deeper check-ins. Again, welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Danbury, where we welcome all in the spirit of compassion, inquiry, and service. Reverend Holly.
Thank you for that wonderful welcome. Our opening words are Broken Hallelujah by Teresa Aisoto. Bring your broken hallelujah here. Bring the large one that is beyond repair. Bring the small one that's too soft to share. Bring your broken hallelujah here. I know that people have told you that before you can give, you have to get yourself together. They overstated the value of perfection by a lot, or they forgot. You are a gift. We all bring some broken things, songs and dreams and lost hopes. But here together, we reach within. As a community, we begin again. And from the pieces, we will build something new. There is work that only you can do. We wait for you. Blessed be.
Please join me now as we all read together our chalice lighting affirmation. Love is the spirit of our congregation, and justice is its light. This is our covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek and speak the truth in love, to help one another, and celebrate life. Now we will move to our children's affirmation.
Good morning. It is good to be together. If there are children and youth who are in the room but not near the screen, it's a good time to come on over. Reverend Holly's story is a picture book, so you'll want to be close for the pictures. Let's say together our children's affirmation, the words for which are printed in the order of service. We are Unitarian Universalists. We are people with open minds, loving hearts, and helping hands. We care for the earth and each other. It's time for Reverend Holly's story. They've made a video reading for us. Our story for all ages this week is A Flicker of Hope by Julia Cook. Have you ever felt like I do? My flame used to be bright and strong, but now it's just a flicker. I have all of these dark clouds hovering over me, but they don't feel like clouds to me. They feel like mountains. I try hard to push them away, but they keep coming back. I'm so tired of trying. You know, a brighter flame can lighten those heavy clouds of yours. Then they'd be easier to push them away. Can you see them too? No, they're your clouds. Only you can see them. But I can tell your flame isn't very bright right now. How do you know? It's not the how I know that matters. It's the what I know. Looks like you could use a little boost of hope. How'd you do that? Since you are standing right underneath your clouds, all you can see is dark. They may seem impossible to move. But when you reach out for help, others can share their gifts with you. Amazing things can happen when you use our gifts. Gifts? What gifts? I don't have any gifts. Your unique light is a priceless gift. No one can light up the world around you like you can. Well, I can't light up anything around me right now. I don't have it in me. Why? Because I can't do anything right. I'm never going to be good enough. Who I want to become seems impossible. And you should hear what people say about me. Bad things? Awful things. Are they true? No, but they might as well be. Everyone thinks they are. Oh, and on top of it all, someone who really matters to me isn't here anymore. Today is just really hard, and I don't know how tomorrow's gonna be any better. In fact, it might even be worse. I'm running out of hope. Then let me give you another little boost. Wow! Look how bright your light is. When your clouds get too dark and too heavy to push away, reach out and ask, can I borrow some light? I'm having a really bad day, but hope builders are everywhere. But only you can see your clouds. So grab some courage and ask for help. And don't worry about being too proud. It's always okay to admit to yourself, I just can't do it today. Everyone needs someone sometimes, but help them find their way. But what if they say no? Then you ask someone else, and you keep asking a bunch of different ways until you find someone who says, yes, just don't ever stop asking. You have to find a way to stay lit no matter what. Why? Because if your flame goes out, you might not be able to relight it. And that would be the saddest thing ever. Why? Because you are needed. You are here for a reason. No one else in the world has a light like yours. You are beautiful, and you have a purpose and a very special gift, even if you might not know what those are yet. But really, how do you know all of this stuff? Because sometimes I have dark clouds hovering over me too, but they do not feel like clouds. They feel like mountains. Only I can see them. I try hard to push them away, but they keep coming back. My flame turns into a flicker, but it's a flicker of hope. Even though it seems like I can't do anything right, and I feel like I'm never going to be good enough, and who I want to become seems impossible, and even though people say awful things about me that aren't true, and everyone believes them, oh, and someone who really matters to me isn't here anymore. I tell myself that I am needed. I remind myself that I matter. I have special gifts to share with others. I choose to believe the world is better with my light in it. And I know that I need some help, so I ask. And I keep asking, and I keep reaching out to others until I find someone who can share their flame with me and give me strength and a little boost of hope. Then amazing things happen to both of us. So when I saw your flame, I just knew I needed to give you a little boost of hope. See, that's what a hope builder does. When you share your light, one little candle can grow into a whole hope-building community. So ends our story for today. Go in peace.
Let's take a moment to settle into our connectedness. Here in this community, we have an opportunity to share our lights with one another. Please write in the chat those personal milestones that are lifting up your heart or weighing it down today. And please do reach out and offer your support or affirmation to one another, whether by chatting with everyone or privately. In these so much online times, it takes a little more effort to truly understand what is going on behind and beyond each other's screens. So please do let one another know how you are on this day.
is now the time in our service where we perform our congregational offering. If you are with us for the first time, feel free to pass the virtual plate, as your presence here is your gift to us. Members, please express your generosity by clicking the link that is posted in the chat to make a donation or pledge. Even though we're not in our sacred space on the ridge, we are creating a holy place together, and our operating expenses remain the same. You may also mail a check to UUCD at 24 Clapboard Ridge Road in Danbury. Thank you for doing your part to support and sustain this community that we love. Please join me now in our congregational response. In the spirit of compassion and service, we dedicate these, our offerings.
Our reading today is The Ups and Downs of Being a Mental Health Advocate. It's written anonymously and talking about mental health can be really difficult. So I wanted to share someone else's words, even someone that is an advocate. Their words are, one of the most detrimental misconceptions surrounding mental health advocacy is the notion that advocates have it all together. Although we as mental health advocates write and speak on some of the most vulnerable aspects of our lives, candidly addressing our own struggles in the hope of spreading awareness and helping others feel less alone, we are perceived as virtually infallible. We are faced with pressures to remain composed at all times, to be self-care superstars, and to advocate in socially conscious ways. But the desire to continue fighting, the expectation that we must always smile, and the notion that we must never have a difficult day can cause our mental health to plummet. This polarizing dichotomy between the perception and reality of mental health advocacy affects me on a daily personal level. Despite my candor regarding my experience with mental illness, others in the mental health community continue to believe that I am winning the battle against my own mind. But they cannot see the days that I struggle with self-care and fight to stay afloat, my mind frozen by anxiety and numbed by depression. I began writing about my mental health conditions because I didn't want others to feel alone as I did when I was diagnosed. I try to be honest about what I'm experiencing in life, and at times it gets hard. There is pressure to not have a bad day, to not break down, to show no signs of weakness. It's silly because it goes against everything I advocate for. I advocate for openness and free expression of how one feels. I want to say I'm always winning because I don't want others to give up. I always smile because I feel the need to be strong for others, but I forget that at times I need to let go of all of that control so others can be strong for me. It's easy to fall into the trap of presenting myself as 100% better. All I wanted was that fairy tale recovery story. But as we all know, fairy tales are not real. My real story of being better for a while, getting worse, being better, getting worse is the most accurate, but also the most inspirational and stigma challenging. I realized after trying to be perfectly well that I didn't need to be perfectly recovered to make change. No matter how inspirational it is to speak, there are days when it is hard to get out of bed, or days when it feels difficult to tell the same story one more time. 2 months ago, I was having one of those days when I needed a little push to get out of bed. I was speaking to sophomores at a high school to their health class. It was early in the morning and the class was super quiet. Just as I began to wonder if anyone was listening, our time was up. And a 15-year-old girl walked up and gave me a hug. I will never forget. I felt her hot tears fall on my shoulder. She said that she had just been diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder 2 days ago and had been contemplating suicide ever since because she felt so alone. I asked her how she felt and how young Maria said, "I'm filled with hopes and dreams for my future. Now I feel strong enough to share my true self with my friends and family. Someday, I hope to be just like you." That day, everything changed for her and for me. This is why I speak. We don't have to do this all alone. We are stronger together. No matter where we are in the recovery process, we all have a voice. We deserve to be heard. Gaining pride and confidence from speaking up and gives us hope and makes all of the ups and downs worth it. For me, as a recently ordained minister and someone that has been on the path and struggling with my own mental health, I found that it is really important to have those conversations. It is something that I feel passionately about in the context of our Unitarian Universalist community. I am not trained as a social worker or a psychiatrist, but I've done some research and have a personal lived experience that I utilize to speak about mental health awareness through a theological lens. I would like to begin by defining mental health. It includes our emotional, psychological, and social well-being, which affects how we think, feel, and act. It also helps determine how we handle stress, relate to others, and make choices. Mental illness likewise impacts some or all of these areas due to genetics, chemical imbalance, trauma, or a combination of these. Unfortunately, mental illness is still fraught with stigma. It's something that isn't discussed as openly as necessary to eliminate stigma and create lasting change. Stigma is often defined as a mark, a blemish or defect, a symbol of shame. It often involves fear of what is different. During a series of adult religious education workshops I developed and led, which focused on mental health awareness and the stigma around mental illness, there was a question that guided our discussions each week. What is the role of the church in addressing stigma? The group came up with these answers, among many others. Education to increase awareness and avoid unintentional harm, respect, support, and advocacy. May we take time to reflect on what it means and how we as UUs can work toward awareness and acceptance through love and compassion. Stigma is discrimination. And it is oppressive. When you speak of being committed to anti-oppression, there are many other things that come to mind before mental health justice work. In 2020, the UU Mental Health Network was formed. Since then, the membership has developed a mission and vision statement. I was honored to be part of these conversations to shape the important work of this new organization. I would like to share the mission and vision statements with you. The mission is to empower the beloved community in honoring each other's unique mental health journey toward wholeness. The vision is that we envision a world where the beloved community is a place where all members are welcomed, understood, and held in love, engages in respectful curiosity to understand emotional distress, welcomes open, authentic, and fearless sharing about mental health, and passionately commits to mental health justice. I am thankful for the development of the UU Mental Health Network. They are working to disrupt the injustice of how individuals with mental health issues are treated by individuals, communities, and medical professionals through their work in UU communities. Everyone has unique needs and deserves to be able to determine how those needs are best met, as well as having community support. I find the continued stigma and discrimination around mental illness to be perplexing. Why do we continue to hide or talk in hushed tones about mental illness? Why do we see it as different or something to be feared? Reason and science tell us that it is just as real as physical ailments, such as heart disease, asthma, or cancer. Similarly, mental illness can have genetic links, represent imbalances in the brain or in the body, or be brought on through external forces beyond our control. 1 in 5 people have or have had a personal experience with mental illness. Now, this is a little bit of an oversimplification of the statistics that vary depending on age, severity of diagnosis, but with that number in mind, if you think about it, you or someone you know, if not several people that you know, are living with mental illness. And sadly, the odds are that if you can't think of someone, it doesn't represent an absence of mental health struggle, but rather the presence of stigma and fear that may be preventing them from sharing their experience with others. In the reading I shared, it reflects on how difficult it can be to overcome stigma, even for advocates or mental health professionals. The author notes that they felt the need to present themselves as well, even when they were struggling and at times needed to fight to prove themselves in order to continue their important work. While I did not write this piece, there are aspects of it that I could resonate with deeply. For me, it has been a process over the last 11 years to learn about and to face my own diagnosis of bipolar depression, to seek therapy and medication, developing coping skills such as mindfulness, meditation, and journaling, and to recognize that there is not a quick or easy fix. It takes time and it takes support. I have at times met stigma veiled in humor, saying, "Oh, you don't seem that crazy," or unsolicited advice, "You shouldn't tell anyone because you might not be able to get a job, or they will judge you." Who is they? These words showed me that those individuals that said it felt that way about my diagnosis, even if they didn't realize that it could have a lasting impact. At first, I let their words bother me. It would have been easier to let their words prevent me from speaking candidly. However, their words spurred me to speak up and to realize why doing so is so important. Change does not and cannot happen without having difficult conversations. For some, such advice might have been taken to heart, and hearing it from others around you could have an impact on mental illness. I often wonder who else might have heard that statement and what they felt. Did it prevent them from being involved with that person or prevent them from reaching out or sharing their lived experience? Everyone is different, though, and recovery can be really difficult, especially without support. Finding the right therapist or medication or coping skills can be daunting because something that might work for one person might be harmful for another. There is not a one-size-fits-all way to address or treat mental health issues. For some, therapy, medication, forced treatment, racial bias, and the existence of trauma can cause greater harm or trauma rather than being beneficial. For some, it requires hard work to push past the stigma to seek help. One such example comes from a blogger that I came across named Jeremy. He wrote that, "I'm not crazy, or at least I don't think I am. It's something I used to say to myself while battling bouts of depression. At the time, I didn't realize that I was internalizing the stigma of mental illness. I defined myself and my illness through the misconception of stigma. I had to realize that I wasn't crazy, which was my first step to recovery." Another story I'd like to share with you just briefly is a woman named Courtney represents how finding the right combination makes a difference. She said that my diagnosis requires that the majority of my treatment is to use coping skills. Some are incorporated into my daily routine, and some are only used on those really bad days. I created a personal daily coping skill self-care checklist. to ensure my continued success in recovery that consists of meditation, a positive affirmation, devotion or prayer, diet and nutrition, physical movement, at least one positive social interaction, a fun activity, and sleep hygiene. A common thread throughout these stories, including mine, is the ways in which community can help create or disrupt stigma. Some of the disruption can help someone move forward. This is a reminder that sharing stories matters when you're ready to share them. Knowing that there are people that will support you matters. Having a trusted friend check in, having someone suggest professional treatment when appropriate, a reminder that you are not alone, that everyone is cared for. Without support, some individuals do suffer alone. For some, it might prevent them from diagnosis or treatment that could help them understand what is going on or help them feel supported by others in their community. Feelings of isolation or being broken or not being enough, of not being accepted, does prevent some from seeking help or community support, whatever that might look like for them. For some, support can make a huge difference. It might even mean the difference between life and death. It may not change the outcome for everyone, but it might for some. These stories were written before the appearance of COVID-19, and we all know that that has changed everything. There are many people with mental illness who have suffered from isolation because it is more difficult to seek professional help or support from one's community. However, many of us felt the impact of global trauma, isolation, and anxiety due to the uncertainty that came with the pandemic. Now might be better. For some, awareness and acceptance is essential as we support and hold one another more fully. Some of you may need to hear these words right now. It's okay if you don't feel okay during all of this. It is okay if you feel anxiety around going back out into public with or without a mask. Everyone has coped differently throughout the pandemic. Some stayed busy while others struggled to stay focused. Just as some of us delighted to re-engage with group events, while others need to approach these changes with great caution. It is okay to feel sad or anxious. It's okay to take things at your own pace. Your life and love are a gift to the world and to the beloved community. You are not alone. You are loved. May it be so, and blessed be. Our meditation words are a prayer called Love Loudly by Carrie Godfrey. Love loudly, spirit of life, of love, and of all that is good and bad and in between. Give me the courage and inspiration to love loudly, to share my joy and compassion with others, to let them know how much I appreciate them. We all give and receive love, but loving loudly is one of the greatest gifts of all. And it is so simple. All it requires is one person who is willing to say to anyone and everyone, you are loved. You are worthy of love. You deserve to be loved. Spirit of life, help me spread love throughout my communities. Help me teach others to love loudly so that it begins to circle round so I can hear it too. Would you now join in Spirit of Life?
We are approaching the end of our service. If you would please join me in repeating after me the declaration to extinguish our chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and out into the world until we are together again. Please now join us for the closing hymn called Comfort Me.
Oh.
May we love loudly all who we are and all of those that are around us, to support one another in times of joy and in times of struggle. May you be reminded that you are not alone and that you are loved. May it be so, and blessed be.
Finally open, the rain and wind stop blowing.